This is tips number 835, which is part one of a six-part series on the ATLAS gear cutting attachment, and this part is entitled Making the Index Housing. Hello again, it's Mr. Pete, your interweb shop tissue. Welcome back to my machine shop, and today I'm starting a multi-part series which will be a gear cutting attachment that can be used on a lathe, namely an ATLAS Craftsman lathe, but I'm sure it'll work on a South Bend and others, and I'll be talking much more about that later. And yes, it's true, I've made many, many videos, and perhaps I'll put some of the links down in the description here, of how to cut gears, but that's all been done on milling machines. Many of you do not have a milling machine, so this is how it can be done on a small lathe if you have the correct cutters and you have a milling attachment and you have this indexing attachment that I'm going to show you right now. And I'm going to start out here by showing you several sets of plans and the history and the background of all of this before I make my first chip, and then we're going to get at it. If this video series is a success, I plan on having follow-up videos where I use it to cut gears like this. Now, this is the reversing gear mechanism off of a 9-inch South Bend lathe, and these gears, you probably can't tell, are totally worn out and shot, and I'd like to make new gears. Notice that the geometry of them is all wrong now because they're so badly worn. So that's in a future video if this works out. So all right, back to the blueprints. This is my worn out tattered copy of the ATLAS 1940 shop equipment catalog. Let me show you the page that I have in question here. This is page 17 of the catalog, and this page is all about their milling attachment, which I just showed you, I believe. But here at the bottom, in a postage stamp size picture, is the attachment that I am going to make. Let me zoom in on that, but it's a very small, poor picture. Okay, here it is, shown on the bottom of this catalog page, and here is a picture of it. But read the description, and I'll zoom in and I'll have close-ups of those at the end of the video with the still pictures, because it's going to be very difficult for you to see this. But the thing is that apparently ATLAS never did manufacture this. In fact, what you would be ordering here is a blueprint, and I do have the blueprint that someone sent to me, and apparently it is still available from Clausing if you would want to buy, or maybe they give that away, maybe it's a e-file or something like that. But read that, and then let's zoom in on this, and I'll talk just a little bit about it, and then I'm going to show you the actual blueprint. Now, to orient you, this picture is taken from the back side of the lathe. The operator of the machine would stand out here, and what you're seeing here vertically is the milling attachment, which I just showed you, and here is the gear cutter held in the spindle of the lathe chuck, and the chuck would be over here where my pointer is, and this is the gear that is being cut. This is the gear that is being copied. So you have to have a gear or an index plate or something that you would be copying, because this is the simplest type of direct indexing. But this is quite interesting, I think. So in order to use it again, you have to have a lathe, you have to have the milling attachment, and you have to have the indexing attachment, as well as cutters, and a strong desire to do this. I'm sorry, but the title block here is cut off a little bit, but this drawing is from 1939. Remember, that catalog was 1940. The draftsman is long dead. Thank you to the person that sent me this drawing. I do not remember who it is. Leave me a note in the comment section if you did. Now let me show you the drawing. Now, I'm no fool. I know you can't see this or read this because it's a rather light picture, and all of the parts are shown on one sheet as opposed to what I'm going to show you here momentarily. But all of the dimensions and everything are on there for one to build this, but I'm going to make modifications of it. But let me zoom in here to the actual assembly drawing here, which is of the most interest to everyone. I hope this shows up at least a little bit for you, but here is the cutter that is held in the spindle or the chuck of the lathe. Again, here is the gear being cut. Here is the gear being copied. This is the main part here with an arbor or a shaft running all the way through, and then an extension going up here with the plunger that fits into the gear teeth. Clear as mud? I have talked endlessly over the years about casting specialties, and this is a rather poor copy of the 1980 catalog. Notice the CS down here, and remember, I have visited casting specialties, and I knew, or I should say, I met Mr. Strzok. But this project is not shown in this catalog. Matter of fact, I was unaware until someone sent me a copy of what I'm going to show you now, and I'm not sure if he violated the copyright law or not, so let's check this out. Okay, this is the drawing from Casting Specialist. Notice the CS logo right here. There's actually two sheets because Mr. Strzok realized that that was way too much information on one page, so he changed it to two pages. But I'm going to tell you right now that he directly copied this from ATLAS. Now, maybe it wasn't copyrighted by ATLAS, and what he did was perfectly legal. But if you examine this assembly drawing with this one, it is identical with just, well, I shouldn't say identical, just some minor changes maybe in the appearance of the gear and so on. And all of the dimensions here are identical to the ATLAS. So he copied it. I'm wondering if he got in trouble and that is why it was taken out of the catalog. But I think more than likely, notice it says here gear cutting fixture, more than likely it just didn't sell. So Mr. Strzok was selling a kit. That is, a casting or the parts needed for a student to make this in the school shop. Now, what I like about this drawing, again, is that it's on two different pages, and it's much darker and bolder and easier, I think, for a student to read because the drawings are larger and the dimensioning is slightly different and I think better for the young mind to absorb. And here is the second page from Strzok. That's really spread out, but easy to read, easy to understand, I think. To confuse you even more, a man, and I think this is on MYHEAP, but MYHEAP isn't working this morning, so I wanted to show you that. I don't know if it's out of commission for good or if there's just a problem, but what he did here, and thank you to that man, and again, his name, it might be Joe Hildreth that did this, I'm not sure, but these might be available if MYHEAP comes up and can be, but look what he did here. There is 10 pages here, so there's a different page for each part, so this would really be easy to understand. Let me run through these real quickly, and there are different versions of the shaft. Not sure why that was done. And this already has been in my possession for about 2 years. But you can see how nicely this is done with a pictorial isometric of each one of the parts as well. I would be very interested to know if there's even one other person in the entire world that might make this. But I know I've been boring you here with drawings, and we're going to get down to the actual chip making here in a minute. Now, these collars could be commercially purchased, and there again is a very nice assembly drawing of what I'm going to do. All right, are you confused or are you happy? Let's get started finally. But to confuse you even just a little bit more, I'm going to take these three different versions and I'm going to make a Peterson fourth version. That is, I'm changing some of the dimensions to fit the tooling that I have and the materials that are available to me. But the general principles here are exactly the same. again, the gear that you're going to cut, the blank would go on that end, and this is how the indexing device actually works. I don't like that knob. They all put that countersunk type knob on there. We'll do something a little bit different. We're going to start today in this video making the main block here. I'm not sure what they call that. I'll show you a dimension drawing of that here momentarily. And unfortunately, I'm going to make this out of aluminum simply because I did not have a piece of 1.5-inch square steel, 5 1/8 long. Here is the part that we're going to make today, and this is the ATLAS drawing, if you prefer to use this drawing. Now let me show you the casting specialty drawing. Here is the drawing of the housing, is what they call it, and this is the casting specialty version, if you prefer to follow that drawing and the dimensions therein. And here is the index housing shown on the drawing from MYHEAP. Again, I'd rather have 1.5-inch thick steel, but I did not have any, so this is what I started with, and I've done some preliminary work. As you can see, I already sawed that off, and that was quite laborious, so not going to use this unless I goof up this. Put that aside, and then I also cut it to length. So again, 1.5-inch thick. There's a layout line, rough sawn, so the very first thing we will do is go over to the mill and mill this down. Now, that's routine work. By the way, I did face this end, but not this end. So I will not show everything, and I will speed up some of the footage to save you the pain. But let's go over to the bridge port and take this down to the line, or should I say, 1.5 inches thick. You know, I've worked with this aluminum before, and this came from an aircraft plant down in St. Louis. Thank you to David for sending that to me a decade ago. But what I experienced the last time that I used this, I found that the corners aren't actually square. So if I can show you here with this square, can you see how that is not square? Now, that sometimes that comes back to haunt you. Maybe it wouldn't in this video, but what I'm going to do here is rather than just mill it to this line, I'm going to take a cleanup cut, and then I'm going to rescribe the line on this guide and take a cut here because I believe that it is parallel in this dimension here. So that's why I am milling both sides, to square it up. Does that make any sense, or is it foolish? Well, that didn't take much, did it? I'm going to flip it over now. Always wear your safety glasses and practice all the safety rules that I have harangued on for years. Okay, what I did now, after milling this, I removed the burrs. Always remove the burrs. Always clean the vise out, and I am on a parallel here. I didn't lay it out because I got about 30 or 35 thousandths to take off. It's not that critical. Also note here, when I set it on the parallel, that I will hang it over the edge here such that I can put a micrometer on there and read it and not have to use a depth mic or anything crazy like that. Okay, let's cut. Okay, I'm going to take 30 thousandths off. I took a final cleanup pass of 6 thousandths, and it is now down to the correct dimension. Not that it is that critical. There's quite an allowance there. It really doesn't matter, but I'm going to try to get fairly close just here for the purposes of instruction. Always deburr. I plan on facing to length and then drilling and reaming a 3/4 inch hole all the way through, but unfortunately, even though this chuck is pretty good size, the 1.5 inches will not go in any farther than the length of the jaws itself. So it's a bit precarious. So what I'm going to do here to start with is center it. I won't show all of that, but then I will drill a center hole in there and support it while I face it and while I... there is a step on there. I'm not sure I showed you that. There is a step. So I'm going to turn it to diameter. I'll show you that right now. And when I come back, this will all be set up properly. So on the drawing, you can see that the end of the piece here will be turned to 1 inch diameter and 3/8 inches long. For your information, I did use a dial indicator and I'm within 1/1000ths or two. Don't waste your time getting it any closer than that. Even 5/1000ths would be plenty. Do not break the tip off of your indicator. Now, I'm going to face it off without benefit of a center. I'm going to use that diamond tool, which I've been rather liking lately. But Mr. Pete, why didn't you use your copper caps on your jaw so you wouldn't put a mark on your work? Well, the reason I didn't is because I forgot, and the reason I forgot is because I'm old and incompetent. Well, next I'm going to face it off to 5 1/8 inches long to that line there, and I, even though I'm only held by about 1 1/4 inches, it's aluminum and there's not a lot of pressure on the tool or the work, so I think it will not slip on me. I'm going to be okay. I sure do like this diamond tool. There'll be a video on that someday. So I'm still in touch with the end of the work. I have drilled a center hole. I'm supporting it. Now that may not be necessary, but the center hole is needed anyway for pre-drilling. So again, when you're turning to a diameter, there is some pressure against the work that could cause it to slip in the vise. That, I know it's overkill. Let me show you another trick here. The tool is still up against the work, so I know the location of the tool. I've got my carriage stop set right here, and I'm using one of the old rusty gauge blocks. You know, people said, why don't you throw those away? But that's a 3/8 inch gauge block, but that's overkill. You could use a 3/8 inch bit. There's so many ways of doing this, or you could simply dial in 3/8 of an inch, 375 thousandths, because there is a graduated dial here. Hundreds of ways to do that, or you don't even need to do this. You can do it with a ruler. Be close enough. This will be off camera, of course, when I start cutting, but the whole idea is I'm cutting up to the stop like that. So it's uniform in length with the longitudinal feed, and the diameter of that step is 1 inch diameter. And I'm right on. Now I've switched from the Sterrett micrometer here, which is a little bit thick right here, to my beloved Lufkin. and I want this to be either 1 or 2 thousandths under as called for on the drawing, so we do not have to struggle it, so I can get in here a little bit better. And I have always preferred a micrometer over a calipers. And I'm right on there. I thought I was a little bit less. No, I am 1 thousandth under, which is good. Now, the other thing I want to check here is, am I truly 3/8? Okay, I want this to actually be 375. I'm a little bit off of my mark, so I will face the end of this off camera so that I'm exactly 0.375. You do not need to see that. One of the beauties about this diamond tool is that it's 80 degrees included angle, so it gets into a shoulder just perfectly. Get yourself one. Question: did you see my two short subject videos? One of them was on stubby drill bits. This is a standard jobber's length bit. And then I had another short subject video on extra long drill bits. Now, this work is over 5 inches long, so I cannot drill my pilot hole with a standard jobber's length. I am going to use one of these quarter inch bits or thereabouts. Now, again, you can't use this kind here because the flutes are not long enough. Otherwise, you'd have to keep backing it out. It would be quite laborious and angering. So I'm going to use, this bit is so long that when they're extra long, they're constantly winding and unwinding. Do you understand what I mean by that? So here's the perfect length one. It's got plenty of flute, and it's not too long, and it's just what I want. Remember, I've already center drilled here, so I will drill all the way through right now, backing off to get rid of the chips from time to time and using plenty of lubricant. Okay, that's what we call deep hole drilling. It's not exactly gun drilling, but notice how I kept withdrawing it to get the chips out of there. You got to get the chips out so it does not bind up and break the bit and spoil your day. Now, normally I go in with a couple other bits, but this time I'm going to use the 47/64. It is plenty long to go all the way through, and that is the one size under, 1/64 under the 3/4 reamer, because ultimately I want a 3/4 reamed hole, do I not? Now I'm ready to ream. You could use a hand reamer, but boy, that's a job and a half with a deep hole and a large diameter reamer. So I'm using a taper shank power reamer, slow speed, never run a reamer backwards, and use plenty of lubricant or you'll end up with an oversized hole. Well, there it is. Turned out pretty well. It's kind of a struggle to drill and ream a big long hole like that, but here's a piece of 3/4 scrap. Fits in there nicely. No slop, but yet turns freely. So I did have to run a hand reamer through there. That took off just a little more. You never know, was this reamer slightly worn or the fact that the flutes are rather short. I don't know why it came up just a little bit tight, but that took care of it. A little bit of fitting, a little bit of deburring, and that completes this part. Well, there are holes to drill in here, and a hole for a clamp and all of that, yeah, but that's easy stuff. So that concludes, again, this video, and in the next video, I'll make that other part, what do they call it? It's called a guide slide. I'll make that. I can't find cold roll steel. I have to settle for hot rolled, but that will fit in there just like that. And I would say I'm already about 1/4 through with this lengthy project. Hope you enjoyed the video. Be sure and watch the still pictures at the end and the other videos as they appear in my queue. This is Mr. Pete saying so long for now. Hope you liked the video. Now I gotta clean up this shop.